the worst part of it was not knowing anything at all about having a baby. There was this great feeling of anger at not being told what to expect. It was very frightening.
Hundreds of lights and mirrors on the ceilings. I'm looking at all these places and, well, that's frightening. Frightening place to be. You wonder whatever they're going to do in there. And then these stirrups hang from the ceiling. What can they do with stirrups?
I said, is this the mortuary? But I'm quite sure I'm going to die in here. And then after a while I got hysterical, and when I got really hysterical, I panicked. Could see no way out of all this pain, and so when I started screaming, the nurse slapped my face.
I didn't know what to expect, and it was really bad. Instead of helping with the pains, I was crying. The nurse, in the end, gave me a slap across my bottom and told me to push, which I did, and the baby shot out, completely out. And she told me I was lucky that it was a small baby, or it had been torn.
It was all covered with mucus and blood, and I was absolutely disgusted. And then she said, now, we'll take the baby away and we'll bath it and weigh it. And you will remove the afterbirth. I said, what's that? Do you not know anything, girl? She said.
In the early part of the century, most women had no idea what to expect when they had their first baby. Often childbirth was made even more traumatic by the attitudes of the medical authorities. For many, it was a shocking initiation into parenthood. The experience of those who brought up children in Britain during the first half of the century has rarely been documented in all its variety and detail. The problems they faced, the advice they were given, and the joys and heartache of being a parent were often very different from today. In particular, childbirth and baby care were fraught with difficulties and dangers, both for the mothers and for the babies themselves. Before the 1930s, the vast majority of women had their babies at home. Medical care was expensive, and working-class mothers in labour would normally only call out the doctor in an emergency.
Before he came into the bedroom, we had to put £2 on the table. And the doctor gave me chloroform and instruments and delivered Charlie. And when he was born, he was the ugliest thing you ever saw in your life. He was cut all down round his neck. His eyes was like big black plums. And his scar right down his head. And that's how they left me.
Inadequate treatment of difficult births like this one often led to infections, such as septicemia, which killed or disabled many mothers.
3 weeks after he was born, I was woke with severe pains in my leg. My husband came in from work and he said, there's a terrible smell in here. And when he turned the bedclothes down, you never smell anything like it in your life. And my leg was covered with corruption. It had burst. And they sent me to the hospital. Cost me 7 and 6 for the ambulance. And I was in the hospital 3 weeks. The sister said, you could have had this leg taken off, because she said that septicemia you've had, and she said you've been very lucky.
When the time comes, the mother may like to have her own family doctor take charge of her case, and a maternity nurse will then act under his instructions.
Well-to-do mothers and their new babies were equally at risk in childbirth. Although they could afford the best medical care, the fashion amongst GPs for using instruments meant that the doctor's presence often actually increased the danger. Rose Luttrell was having her first baby in 1916 when her nurse called the doctor.
I don't think they realised that the baby's head was jammed against my spine. And as I had every pain, instead of the baby coming forward, it was being jammed again more and more against my spine. And eventually they used the forceps and delivered him by instruments and crushed his skull. And I was very badly torn. And his brain was damaged. But luckily he only lived for 2 days, a 10-pound baby. Nothing wrong, absolutely perfect baby, but his skull was crushed with the instruments.
Happily, Rose Luttrell went on to have 4 healthy children during the 1920s. In the first decades of the century, having babies dominated the lives of women. Many people knew little about birth control and had no access to contraception, so constant pregnancies and large families were common, especially amongst the working classes. Ivy Summers and her husband Harry were married in Grimsby in 1919 when she was 18. Their first baby was born a year later.
A year after that had our May. 14 months after that had Harry. 2 years and 2 months after that had our Rainey. And 18 months after that had Rainey had Arthur. And 2 years and 4 months after I had our Arthur, I had Valerie. And after I had Valerie, I had Dennis. And then I had Terry. And they had Pat. And Norma. And David. They just rolled up one after the other. And then 12 children. Well, it's been like chucking you in the deep end. It never bothered me, though.
Mary Siddle and her husband Fred were married in Oldham in 1921 when she was 22.
I never wanted a big family. I just wanted the 2. But they just come. I had 10 children. I told my husband I was fed up of having babies, but he didn't believe in any contraceptions or nothing like nor birth control, my husband didn't. Oh, so... But I kept thinking, everyone I have, that'll be the last now, but they still kept coming.
Mary Hardy and her husband James were married in Motherwell in 1929 when she was 17. After the difficult birth of her first baby, she went to one of the early birth control clinics.
So I came home and I said to my husband, "Now look, I've been asking at the clinic and they say you should get a French letter." Well, my husband was so quiet and withdrawn about this. He says, "Oh," and he didn't say yes or no, and he didn't, so we didn't.
They were difficult to get in those days. There used to be certain shops where you knew they sold them, and you used to go by it as if you were asking for something that you shouldn't ask for, you know, that kind of thing. They were sort of looked down on a wee bit.
He would have been too embarrassed. He was quite shy.
I never used them, you see, and as you know, a condom's not the same at all as the natural thing, so felt that way about it, yeah.
I refused to sleep with him in the bed. Not that he demanded it, he realised that I was terrified of having more children, and he was very good.
Well, it was just a case of either that or more kiddies, you know, so we decided we'd be strong-willed and sleep separate beds. Yes? Did that for a while.
Human nature being what it is, we did want to be together, but we were so careful and they always stopped before...
There's the odd the odd accident happens, yes. Sometimes you're happy about it, didn't really matter. You're quite happy to have your family, yes.
Mary and James ended up having 8 children.
But we just accepted it. We thought, oh no, here we go again, you know, through the old routine. And there you are, we just had it, and that was it. Mm-hmm.
Pregnant mothers with large families had to carry on running the home, often helped by their elder children, right up to the moment of birth, which they prepared for themselves.
If you got up in the morning and you was in labour, you got through your day, see that your house was all in order, and then you'd bat the bairns and put them to bed, and then you'd make your bed ready to be confined on. You used to fold a sheet up to about that square, and then you put a sheet of brown paper on that, and that's what you laid on that to be confined on.
A handy woman, usually an older neighbour, would sometimes help with the birth.
Mrs. Crassell, who was going to look after me, put the baby's things out and took one of the napkins and rolled it into a long sausage. I wondered what on earth she was doing it for. Then the doctor dived down his bag and came out with a pair of forceps, so I knew that something unpleasant was going to happen. Inserting the forceps was bad enough, but when he started pulling on them, I thought he'd made a mistake and caught my eyes and was pulling them out as well. I opened my mouth to let out a shriek, and Mrs. Crassell promptly popped the napkin sausage straight into my mouth. So no sound came out hardly. That was our anaesthetic in those days.
A towel is placed on the end of the bed, and you catch with the two hands and pull on the towel with every pain. And I pulled so hard, I was pulling myself over the other side of the bed. It helped a little by grabbing the towel, but not a lot. It was very painful.
Well, it didn't make a row because the kids was in the next bedroom, weren't they? Every husband was downstairs. Didn't want to frighten him to death. No, I never made no noise. I just used to hold myself, grin, bear it.
In many homes, childbirth was still seen as the preserve of women.
How's my water getting on, Mrs. Anderson?
Ready as soon as you like, miss.
I didn't want a doctor or a man near me. I just wanted the midwife there. I never heard of the husband being there like they are today when the babies are born. I couldn't undress me in front of a man, although my husband had all these babies. But I couldn't.
Home births were usually organised by older women in the family. Fathers and sons would be kept well away.
Now then, my son, you're in my way. Come along outside and amuse yourself. That's right.
My father had 9, and he wasn't at the birth of one of them. No, that wasn't his place, because I suppose I took after him, like. And I was manly. I was a big, tough. A body on me like a tree trunk. I thought, this is no place for me. I'm a man, I'm not one of these shilly-shally folks, you know, wanting to be on something they shouldn't be on. And I thought, well, I'm not going to start that silly game.
But John's wife Hilda wanted him to be present at the birth, and she made this somewhat unusual request to the midwife.
She says, get hold of these towels on the, you know, through the top of the bed. They had the towels, and you had to grab those when you were in pain. And I says, well, I says, can Dad come? And I can grab him, you know, oh, no, she says, no. She says, we don't want to, it's better downstairs, she says, boiling the water for us. She says, than up here. She says, it'd only get in the way.
And then, of course, when the midwife says, oh, there's no room here for your husband, you know, thought, well, that'll satisfy me. I'm not wanted up there, and I didn't want to go up there, so That was it.
I says, I wish he was here. So she says, no, she says, you can't have him.
I was getting a tot to do a whiskey down me as well, wasn't there? To give me courage.
He just went on and on with the pain, and it got worse and worse, and then, of course, the baby was born. And then he could come up.
I just filled up, you know, with emotion. Relief, that's what it was. Just a great relief.
Can't ever remember my husband holding a new baby. I would say, Fred, will you take baby out in the pram while I make the dinner? No way. No. So I did all that. One in a cot, one in a pram.
The mother had to do all the nursing the baby that time. The baby cried all night. The mother had to nurse the baby all night. And the father never had to do anything. And I was so tired in the day, I'd fall asleep feeding the baby, and the bottle would fall from my hand to the floor.
Baby and childcare was left almost entirely to the mother. With little or no help from their husbands, women had to be remarkably resourceful.
When I was doing my washing, I had to tie the two littlest ones in chairs, one in the armchair, one a rocking chair, with a scarf so they wouldn't get anywhere near the hot water. And never had anything happen to them.
When they were tiny babies and they had wind, I used to make cinder tea. And it was very common in the north in them days. Take a cinder out of the fire, a red hot cinder out of the fire, put it in a cup of cold water, let it stand a few seconds, and then put some sugar in. You stir it up and you let it stand, and then you sieve it into another cup. When it's all settled, you put it in the baby's feeding bottle, and then you give it your baby. Hold the baby on your shoulder like that, and you rub your little back, and then it brings it wind up. It's all right after, as simple as ever, and it causes nothing.
Despite the extraordinary efforts made by working-class mothers to care for their babies, they were still vulnerable to serious illness and death, particularly during their first year.
My first baby cried continuously, day and night. He was very small, 3.5 pounds, so the doctor said to keep him warm, but I couldn't do that. I had no heating in the bedroom, couldn't leave him downstairs because at night there's cockroaches there. And he didn't gain any weight. Then he started to lose weight. And then he died at 3 months old. And I was heartbroken. I thought I'd never get over that, but I shall never forget him.
It was a lovely bed. Rosy cheeks, lovely fair curly hair. He'd only been ill for about an hour. It was about 5 o'clock at night, and he was real warm, you know, and that. And I sent him for the doctor, and when the doctor came, he said, oh, he just got a slight chill. He said, put him to bed. He said, we're just starting with M and B tablets. They're just like a saccharine. He said, give her half of one in his bottle of milk. So I put half of one in his bottle of milk. And don't forget, he was a lovely baby, never fat, beautiful baby he was. And I sit on the rocking chair, was singing to him. He fell asleep. I just laid him down and he stopped breathing. Every drop of blood drained from me. I just walked about as though I was a zombie, as though I was dead. So I went to the undertaker and I said to him, I wonder if you could bury my baby. I said, I've no money to bury him. I said, but I'll pay you so much a week. So he said, come in. He said, yes, I will. And he charged me £2.10 in them days, £2.50 as it is now. And I paid him half a crown a week till it was finished.
At the turn of the century, around one in every six babies did not survive beyond their first birthday. To overcome what was seen as a major threat to national strength, there was a health drive, backed by the government, to improve childbirth facilities. But there was a harsh side to hospital care, as childbirth became a highly regimented surgical event.
I was terrified. They stripped me and put me in a hot bath, washed with carbolic soap, it stung mightily, especially my eyes, and I resented that. She told me to lie back in the bath and she shaved me with an ordinary open razor and cream. That was not very nice and I was so embarrassed. She said, "Now keep still." I said, "I don't like this." And I couldn't understand why she was doing it. I said, "Sure, but that's not necessary." She said, "It makes it easier for you and us." But I still did not understand. I had to accept it.
Hospitals were increasingly organised on a production line basis, and women in all stages of childbirth had to conform to strict rules and regulations.
Eventually the baby came. They let me sleep for about half an hour and I was wakened up with them making me sit up, and they opened my nightdress and clamped the baby onto my breast. And oh, that was like, it was like getting a tooth drawn. It was so very painful. And I said, this hurts too much. I don't want to be hurt anymore. Nonsense, girl, you've got to feed your baby. And I said, "No, put it on the bottle." "No, no," she said, "you're perfectly healthy. You're able to feed your baby."
Breastfeeding, of course, is most important. Try your best to give the child this a great advantage of a good start in life.
From the 20s onwards, breastfeeding was officially recommended as essential to a healthy and well-trained baby.
Remember, feed by the clock. No nibbles between meals and no night feeds. 4-hourly feeding is good enough for most babies.
Feeding by the clock was part of a broader regime of habit training, the brainchild of a New Zealand doctor, Frederick Truby King. In 1913, he wrote his best-selling book, Feeding and Care of Baby. It was the standard work in the new and influential science of mothercraft, and it became a Bible for some middle-class mothers.
Truby King was the tops, and what he didn't know about how to bring up a baby, you know, was nobody's business, and you just wanted the best for your baby. And because I wanted the best for my baby, and a lot of other mothers as well, we thought that the Truby King method was the answer.
The Truby King method of baby care was promoted by the new health visitors. By the 1930s, there were more than 5,000 making regular home calls.
Well, the little squeezer, still at it.
He's worse than anything. I can't think what's wrong with him.
Probably nothing very much. You're all right, aren't you? Except your little bristle, and your nasty temper.
And how do you suppose I can cure him of that?
Ask your mother to take him to the welfare centre. They'll teach you how to keep him well, and he'll be as happy as a sandboy.
Clinics were set up all over Britain to instruct mothers in the correct methods of baby care. There were some health benefits.
£13.7.
But the advice given was often extraordinarily rigid.
Well, Mrs. Howard, 14 weeks old, is he? Gives you rather more music than you care for, eh?
Yes, doctor. Night and day, we don't get any sleep with him.
Well, there's certainly nothing wrong with him. He looks to me as if he ought to make a good heavyweight boxer. It's just a question of balanced diet and digestion. And above all, regular feeding. And when I say regular, I mean regular. By the clock, mind. Now, I want you to follow out these instructions exactly as I've written them. You'll find them perfectly straightforward.
It was too regimentated. You 4-hourly, and then you didn't do anything at all for the next 4 hours. And all you did was to pick her up and feed her, change her nappy, pat her back, and put her back in the pram.
Even physical contact between mother and baby was regulated.
That was something that we did bar, was kissing. But I kiss her little body and I kissed her neck, but never kissing her as such. And I wouldn't allow anybody else. As a matter of fact, to a point, if you had a cold, you wore a mask, which I did. If I had a cold, I never went near Shirley unless I had a mask on. And I suppose that was the order of the day. That's what we were told to do.
While this approach to baby care was increasingly taken up by middle-class mothers, others simply chose to ignore the advice.
I used to love them and kiss them and cuddle them up and that. No, and I never left them to cry. If there was crying, I used to pick them up. The lady doctor at the clinic, she said to me, how do you feed the baby? I said, well, I feed them when they're hungry. If I think they're hungry after 2 hours, I feed them. Well, you don't want to feed them after 2 hours. You should go 4 hours. I said, what, let them cry for 2 hours? Well, they're not hurting anything. I said, well, I feed them my way.
The clinics had their ideas of how to bring a baby up and how to look after the baby, but we had our own ideas in Wales and nursed the baby Welsh fashion, which was wrap the shawl around the baby, around the mother, and underneath your arm, so the baby was curled up against the mother and the baby could hear the mother's heart beating. And that worked every time. The baby always went quiet with that. I used to try singing them to sleep sometimes. I used to try to sing in Welsh. Mae fi sy'n fach gen ie iang ffôl yn byw yn ôl fy ffansi yn mynd yn weld y fain i'r fach ar lan a'ch lan a'ch bainydd.
By the 1940s, the Truby King method was all pervasive. The rigorous training of babies fitted the wartime ethos of rationing and regulation. Mortality rates for mothers and babies were falling, but Ministry of Health films gave little credit to the mothers themselves.
Here's a new life arrived, safe and sound. We did all that we could to bring him safely and happily into the world. Isn't that so, Mrs. Brown? What are you going to call him?
Jack.
Jack. Not a bad name.
The mother was, in my estimation, a somewhat inferior, silly creature who had to do what the medical authorities told you. And if you didn't, then clearly you were failing.
So in Britain, we are striving to give them all the right start now, so that they may be able to carry that responsibility.
Can't help wondering whether that mothers, certainly young mothers like myself, weren't rather despised. That was the feeling at the end of the day, that we were just machines there to produce this child, to bring it up in the right way, whatever that might be.
Our care of the mothers and infants doesn't stop when they leave hospital.
I was of very little account apart from producing him and then sticking to the rules.
And go for help and advice on the health, diet and general care of their youngsters.
When you went to the infants clinic, you weren't called Mrs. So-and-so, you were called Mother. And you lost your identity. I wouldn't answer sometimes. It just depended on what I felt. If I felt cussed, I just wouldn't answer. And until they had to come up to me and Mrs. Goodman, I said, you said Mother. I didn't know that all of us mothers here. So I didn't know whom you meant.
It was as if mothers were expected to do their bit for the country and the war effort by following an almost militaristic regime with their babies.
Well, we were encouraged to bring them up more or less like robots in those days. They had to do everything to time. And I don't know, it might have been because of the war that everything was in short supply and everything was so different. Everything, that's why they were so strict about the way you brought them up.
Gladys and Donald Locke felt under pressure to follow the official advice to the very letter.
Once having put the child to bed, you should never, don't matter how much that baby cries, you should never pick it up. because that was the worst thing you could do. So for the first week or so, the baby was bathed, fed, and put to bed, and that was it. Then my husband would lock the door, put the key in his pocket, and nobody could go in to see that baby, because it says in the book you shouldn't touch them. But it upset me, because being it was my first baby that I had, a baby cries and you want to pick it up. And I desperately wanted to go and cuddle that baby, but of course he was very, very strict on it. He would not let me.
After the first fortnight, the nurse or health visitor may take over the supervision of the baby from the midwife. Here she is making certain that baby gets plenty of fresh air.
We were always told that we should put the babies out every day, unless it was terrifically bad weather.
A mistake many young mothers make.
She wasn't there more than half an hour. But then I thought it seemed to be getting colder, because we were cold indoors. And I brought her in, and it was then that she started to be ill. And that night she got worse and she couldn't breathe. And I had to send for the doctor. And the doctor said, I'm afraid it's the start of pneumonia. And she nearly died, actually. She was ever so ill. I suppose if I'd have been sensible and not been so conscientious, I wouldn't have let her go out in the cold weather. But I felt guilty if I didn't. I seemed to think, oh, she's got to go out once a day. They said that all babies should go out once a day.
Early training is of great importance. From the third day, the nurse should have a small chamber on her knee. The cold rim should just be allowed to touch the child at the back of the anus, and very soon a reflex is established. Many nurses train their babies so that they have no soiled napkins after the first week or so, and very few wet ones. Well, I've never heard anything so ridiculous. I mean, they insisted on that in the clinic. They kept saying, no, you must get in potty trained. I mean, either I was a total dead loss or something. My baby went on peeing all over the place, and he would get off the pot and shit beside it for months and months and months. So, I mean, that really is a load of old crap, to be honest.
A more tender and relaxed approach to baby care came into vogue after the war. The welfare state was being built. There was a ferment of liberal ideas and a new guru of childcare, an American, Dr. Benjamin Spock. In 1946, he wrote his revolutionary bestseller, The Common Sense Book of Baby and Childcare. Spock rejected much of the rigid habit training that had been insisted upon for the previous 30 years. Margaret Swanton had her second baby, Christopher, in 1947.
It was like a Bible, you know, I mean, I just read this thing from cover to cover, and I felt so delighted. I thought, this is wonderful. With the second baby, where there was this far more relaxed attitude, and above all, the emphasis on mother having an intuitive sense about her child's well-being was so different from this other regime. I mean, it was just like heaven sent. It really was. It was a wonderful release.
It looks an ordinary sort of house, this house at Uxbridge, don't it? But it ain't, see, because here lives Mrs. Annie Wilkinson, what's got 13 kids. And it don't half keep her busy, what with the washing and the feeding of them all and that.
One major social trend, and another great release for mothers, was the reduction in family size.
Anyone would think they might be downhearted with all their mouths to feed, but not likely. They even sings, fit to bust the camera.
Large families like the Wilkinsons were becoming a novelty. Florence was the eldest daughter of Mary and Fred Siddle.
My mum had 10 children, 6 girls and 4 boys. And I saw a lot of struggling there. Financially, I've seen her really worrying. You know, what shall I give Dad for his tea and what shall I give the children? It was really hard for her. But she never ever grumbled. But I couldn't have been like that. I couldn't have gone through life like that.
Florence herself had to give up work to look after the family when her mother had her 10th baby.
My mother had always taught us how to cook, you know, to the best of our ability at that age, and I was making what we call a meat and potato pie. And I had to peel these potatoes. They must have been 7 or 8 pounds for the, and I did it. And then when I'd finished, I just sat down and cried. I thought it was a terrible thing to have to do. And then all the cleaning and the washing and everything.
Women of Florence's generation wanted control over the number of babies they had. And clinics promoted the trend towards smaller families by offering advice on contraception.
I had one son, and I was quite happy about that. And we decided to use contraceptives. And you just went to the chemist and just asked for a packet, and there was Durex, 3 for half a crown. So when we was both working and we drew the wages, that was a priority. That come before the groceries.
By the early 1950s, the health and welfare of mothers and babies had improved dramatically, and the worst dangers which surrounded childbirth in previous generations had been significantly reduced.
Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday to you! Happy birthday, dear Anne! Happy birthday to you!
Ivy Summers has just celebrated her 91st birthday. She is a remarkable survivor from an age when mothers brought up large families virtually single-handed, using their instinct and ingenuity to cope in extraordinarily difficult circumstances.
I've no regrets at having the kids at all. I've had 12 children, and the first one was born in 1920. I've got 49 grandchildren, 120 great-grandchildren, and 17 of the fifth generation. There's worse things than having families.
Memory of your joy.